Congratulations, both of you.
First, I would like to thank my partner for bringing me here and allowing me to debate Parli, which was something I didn't think I'd ever be able to do. Specifically, I'd like to thank the judges for adjudicating this round. This is both important and a very special position which you hold in my heart. And of course, my opponents who I saw during my very first eliminations round back at Claremont, where I saw them debating the science topic. It's an honor to be debating them. To be debating. First, it's very clear. Over 32 million people in America are affected by domestic abuse every day. That's 10%, or not every day, 10, just in general. That's 10% of the U.S. population. 40 to 60% of the people who abuse their partners also abuse their children. But furthermore, the girls who are whose parents battered them and their other spouses are 6.5 times more likely to be assaulted by their spouses when they get married. 4 million individuals are assaulted per year, and every day, 4 individuals are killed during domestic disputes with their partners. Therefore, we offer the following case. Specifically, before we get there, I'd like to offer the resolutional analysis. The first is the definition of privacy. That's the state of being free from intrusion of disturbance in one's private life or affairs. But furthermore, also this house we're going to parametricize down to the U.S. federal government. Believe is, of course, to be resolved in or in strong support of, but also furthermore, we are going to look that we're going to provide a policy based on this belief, and we're going to show the resolution true through that. Ultimately, you're going to be looking on institutional instrumental net benefits. What I mean by this is that you're looking specifically at the effects of plan and the effects that it garners inside the round. Inherency. First off, we see that domestic abuse is the number one killer of individuals, specifically those who identify themselves as women. But also, secondly, you're going to look that they're not taken seriously by police because they are never, ever, like, they're not represented, right? We have this dichotomy that we create of public versus private, and that creates this resistance by police to ever take those spousal abuses seriously. Furthermore, I want you to look that even if the information is currently public on whether or not there has been domestic abuse previous, it is slow and inefficient to get to it. The ultimate privacy here and the resistance structurally, culturally, means that only 17 states even bother keeping data on whether or not domestic abuse has occurred previously with an individual. Therefore, we offer the following plan. The U.S. federal government will create a registry for domestic abuse violators, and specifically those who have been convicted, and leave that open on the internet, specifically, and to all police departments.
Can you read it again? Slower.
The U.S. federal government will create a registry for domestic abuse violators and specifically put it on the internet, leaving it available for the community and police. Solvency. The first off is that this open registry creates a massive deterrence. You never want to be labeled as a domestic abuser because you never get a date again. But also, secondly, you're going to see that neighbors are able to check specifically on whether or not, if they believe domestic abuse might be happening, they can check the registry to see whether or not you would increase the likelihood of it, which means the neighbors are going to be intruding on their privacy almost on a daily basis to ensure that this doesn't happen. Third, you're going to look that the police are going to be able to investigate specific cases much more effectively and will be forced to take seriously the claims of an individual based on this now public information. And fourth, just like we saw with sex offenders, once you have a registry, there's a massive influx of awareness generally of the issue and specifically support of it and support for those who have been abused. Moving on to the advantages. The first is domestic. Oh, your question, sir?
Yeah, so on your plan, you're basically saying that people who have been convicted as like doing these sorts of things will be listed
on
a
registry. Yes.
Okay. Cool.
Moving on to domestic abuse. The first off is that there is massive amounts of violence that happens within our culture that is completely hidden from your view based on this public-private dichotomy. The second is that this feeds a generational cycle. Well, as you saw with the statistics that I provided earlier, you're more likely, specifically 6 times more likely, to pick an abusive spouse if your parents were abusive in their own relationship. Furthermore, this is based on the lack of recognition by the police force. This ultimately creates an atmosphere of dehumanization where we don't take individuals who are being domestically abused seriously and we don't consider them as the same context as someone who got assaulted or mugged on the street. This is directly drawing the line because of the public-private dichotomy. And fifth, this non-recognition leads to millions of deaths that are ultimately thousands of deaths that you see every year within our own culture. Advantage two is the cycle. And children. Specifically, we're able to cut out the cycle of children because teachers are able to get, and teachers and counselors and administrative staff are able to look into the background of the parents and make sure that if there is abuse going on in the home, like between the two spouses, that that's not being carried over to the children. This ultimately saves the children, which is why you vote for plan. But also, secondly, you're going to look at previous to any type of plan being passed, they couldn't do this based because it's so hard to look through public records based on the court system. But finally, this alters the amount or the recognition of probable cause. Currently, there's a standard in place that allows state actors, like specifically the police, to go in and arrest based on previous actions, right? But because the information is so slow and intangible to get to, even repeat violators aren't arrested based on this probable cause. Feminism. You know it was coming, the critical implication. A, although domestic abuse is illegal in the status quo, it may be illegal in every state, it still continues to be rampant because of our confusion on whether or not it is a public or private issue. The B point here is that the reason violence is still delegated within the house is because of the privacy that is created. These privacy rights only protect those who are the abusers. Not right now. Furthermore, the plan is the first step in the towards pragmatic and discursive attempts to destroy the public-private dichotomy in the law, which is and in the social sphere. By having the U.S. federal government create a new registry system for those who are who commit these crimes, we deter the crimes, but also we provide a check against abuses. Additionally, the breakdown of this binaryism is significant in two ways. Therefore, the impacts. One, femicide. We recognize that women's rights abuses and human rights abuse are human rights abuses. The femicide that occurs is the ultimate impact because it is a form of genocide that is carried on within our own country and based on a social notion in the category of gender. This impact impacts millions of women as a meta-impact in this round. But also, secondly, the structural and institutional inequality that happens within the public-private sphere ultimately creates and justifies the norms that we consider as comprehensive gender disempowerment. This creates the dichotomy by allowing us to be against the GLBT community and transgender folks. Also, furthermore, it decreases sexism because it increases progress, which gets us back to our rank mechanism.
Is going to be analyzing resolution. We're going to say that value debate is good and that the resolution is a value statement, not a policy statement. The A points is going to be that the resolution is the resolution and value. The first reason that there's no action or verb in the resolution. It simply says that this House believes in something. A belief doesn't necessarily imply any kind of action. Where you specifically have action verbs, belief isn't an action verb. It's distinct. Second, we say that belief is a descriptive, but not a prescriptive statement. So it's saying that I have a belief in something. So since we're from Biola, let's use the obvious example. Steve and I have a belief in God and a belief in Christianity, but that doesn't imply that there's any coming prescriptive action that necessarily follows from that. Someone can now ascribe to a variety of beliefs. That doesn't mean that they have to act upon said beliefs. B is going to be the standards. The first standard is going to be limits. We're going to say that the resolution has to have some sort of limits. They simply can't bracket in words or bracket in verbs or suddenly change the way words function to be able to have it. So we think there always should be some sort of limitation on the way the words. Otherwise, the government can team and do whatever they want. But the second standard, I think, is always going to be grammar. We think that the way belief function as a descriptive statement, not as a prescriptive statement, you're always going to be preferring the grammar resolution because that's something predictable. Steve and I can evaluate grammar to know what they could possibly mean. We don't know what they evaluate, like what possibly could take place in the Reno mind, other than the fact that we have the resolution as predicator. The third argument, the third thing here is just going to be fairness. We think that we should be able to evaluate the trichotomy of the resolution and evaluate a resolution of that kind of argument. The fourth argument is going to be contextuality and usage. We think that when the words used in common usage, when someone has a belief in something, that doesn't necessarily they have an action. Sometimes they're correlated, but it's not a necessitated correlation. We think that's a false correlation when it is. So we say that the word, when it's used properly, is specifically referring to that. So C is going to be the violation. Look at the plan. Plan isn't just doing something about belief. Plan is doing something about action, and we think that it's not what the resolution is asking for, as it's a trichotomy of the statement. The D is going to be the voters. The first voter is going to be an a priori. We think that basically they have to uphold the resolution the way it is, but they're trying to turn it into a false resolution at this time. The second voter is going to be fairness. Steve and I should be able to engage in a critical value debate, not specifically any kind of other debate. We should be able to talk about beliefs and whether convictions are okay and what convictions we have about privacy, not that kind of thing. Third, we're going to just say jurisdiction. You only have what the term is provided you as a topic, not what Reno would like you to have. So the same way a civil judge can only vote on a civil case, you can only vote on the tournament case, not the Reno case. But that let's get into the second off-case position about called double jeopardy. The A point is going to be ruling. So this is basically an open registry. So anyone who has ever been convicted of any kind of domestic abuse goes in the open registry. So the B point is give the breaks. First of all, they've already been convicted and punished if they've been convicted. That means there's already been a punishment for their crime because they've have been convicted. The second one on here, we'd say that this has a mentality of guilty until proven innocent, which is contrary and antithetical to the way the law system functions in the United States. The law says you're not guilty until you've been proven to do something. Just because you have done something in the past does not mean that you're suddenly going to be guilty again. But third, we know that the way specifically domestic abuse functions, like your neighbors can call you for domestic abuse and then they can show up, and if there's any kind of like marks on the man or the woman or the child, that can be identified. And so we said it's always a scenario where people might not actually be engaging in domestic abuse, or if a spouse says that she's been abused, and a male or a female says they've been abused, or whatever is the ambiguous sexuality of the person in question. If they say they've been abused, then that always means that the person is convicted. So we think that for a lot of problems. So C is going to be the implications. First, we say that this is always going to be taking back a lot. This turns the case because a lot of this stuff talks about like these people not having their autonomy violated, or when you're talking about the femicide on the bottom, that they should be able to have some agency and no limitations of agency, but this is always a limitation of agency because you're being guilty until innocent, it's double jeopardy, and oftentimes we're saying it's people that aren't guilty of a lot of the crimes that they're talking about in question, not at this time. You didn't take any of ours, so I'll probably only take one later on. The second argument is saying that it's increased, people are assumed guilty, and so what this always means is that the problem that does in the structure in the public-private dichotomy, as far as we're concerned, is that means that people in the private sphere are always going to be predicated as guilty. So when they're predicated as guilty before they're punished as crime, this means the state's always reaching into the private sphere. The state's always able to point out what's private and what's not, what's good and what's not, and we think that's problematic because that gives state complete reign over the private sphere and a complete reign over a person's innocence and over whether or not they have to be in prison. The third off-case position is going to be a criticism. The A point is going to be the framework. We're going to say that words and discourse are words and advocacy are inextricably connected. You can't have one with the other. We also know that the words help to shape the reality we talk about. So how we talk about things is also one of the key. This is a key thing about how things are valuable. And I'm getting tired, so if I'm not super clear, I apologize. The second argument is that the only thing that stays and goes out of the mouth of this debate is the analytic paradigms on how we phrase things and how we evaluate things. So the synthesis of these points is what's more important is the in-round discourse and the way we talk about things, not necessarily the fiat game. Jumping over to their case on their framework argument, they say specifically that they're talking about like just within the plan argument or not within the context of fiat, but I would say that fiat's always illusory, the plan never actually happens, so what we're advocating is what's important because they have choice over their advocates and we have choice over ours. So B is going to be the links. The first problem on the link level is you're going to find it on their third advantage on feminism. They say that women basically have this, that they're violated by this rights, etc., that there's this unique kind of feminine essence. They're saying that women are being violated, there's this femicide and that kind of things. The C is going to be the implication. The first implication is they're identifying and sexualizing all women as having the same experience. We would note that women have a variety of different experiences. That's why in the critical scholarship on the topic, there's like Latino critical faith race feminism. There's a variety of different things because we would say that they all have different epistemological standpoints and they have a variety of social forces affecting their identity. Specifically, we'd say that a black lesbian woman is going to be different than a white woman who's straight. There's always going to be different experiences. So you can't just identify a woman's experience as the same, which is what's taking place in the third advantage. Sure.
How do you construct the essentially the position of your team? How does the identity of a woman get constructed?
That's going to be the next critique. You wait for that. I'll answer that. So the C, the D point is going to be the implication. We think this kind of essentialism is never going to lead to any kind of problem solving for the issues that they're always going to talk about. In the literature, this is called intersectionality. We should be evaluating women at, or people, rather, at the very social axes of power intersect. So where sexuality intersects with race, where it intersects with class, where it intersects with all the power structures, and that's how we're ever going to solve the problems. Otherwise, they're just going to repeat each other. So if we're thinking that we're solving alleged gender issues, then this is never going to solve other kinds of oppression. It masks other kinds of oppression, how race functions at that intersection, and how that kind of at that intersection. So we say that it always masks oppression and perpetuates oppression. But the second argument under here is we would note that it just delegitimizes, and because it's assuming a universal feminine experience, that never means that the solutions are actually being made. So the women who need specific, not just general state, blanket universal statements of the state, which is the problem of case with the privacy laws, you need to have it specialized. You're never going to have that in case. So D is going to be the voter. The first voter is always going to be our rejection. You simply don't allow for that essentialism of women. But second alternative, you're going to say that you allow people to philosophically understand themselves as whoever they want, whether or not that's male or female or black or white. They can construct it on themselves instead of being constructed as women by them. Now go to their third advantage. I think this is where we're going to be winning debate. They talk about gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender issues, but the problem is they're always reifying the male-female binary all throughout the speech. They say they get offense here, but I would argue that they never do because they create what Judith Butler calls the zone of exclusion. So as soon as they're talking about feminism or femicide, they're assuming there's such a thing as feminine. That means they're never going to get the transgender impacts that they're talking about. Because if there's a female, if there's a male, that creates that binary, but there's always something in the middle. There's always the transgender, there's always the people that are androgynous, there's the people that aren't born with those genitalia, so they're never getting the GLBT stuff, and I would say that it's always going to be an impact because they exclude them, and that leads to all stuff they talk about.
It doesn't matter how much I like my partners from Biola. The reality is that they're going to lose this round specifically because they never really touched the on-gays debate, right? Like, they never deny any of the solvency in the round, which is the voter that I'm going to put, like, on the flow right now, even though it's not a rebuttal. But because we believe that they, to some extent, like, don't tell you why our weighing mechanism is inherently bad, besides the topicality that I will address in a few minutes, I would argue that they don't give you any net benefits over the status quo, right? Like, they don't tell you how many, how individuals are going to be protected or, to some extent, like, not harmed post-criticism. But now let's talk about the topicality. First, they get up here and they talk about how value is a good thing. You know, like, we should have a value debate because belief implies action in terms of, well, not action, but actually just believing something, therefore arguing in terms of value. My first argument is that the affirmative always has the right to parametricize, right? It's up to the affirmative to debate the resolution on either a fact debate, a value debate, or a policy debate. And in this case, we just chose to exercise that right. My second argument is that when the resolution says believe, that's only a way to, we would argue that the only way to assess a belief is through action, right? Like many people that believe in the war in Iraq actually support the action of the United States being in Iraq, which means that they're creating this false dichotomy between action and belief, which we argue is problematic. Now onto the standards. They say limits. My first argument is a feminist term, right? Like this is exactly what we argue by means of the public-private dichotomy, the assumption that there are limits of where you should go and where you shouldn't go, where you, what you should talk about and what you shouldn't talk about. This once again links me back to the feminism argument and all the impacts that go with that. But secondly, I would argue that we turn their predictability argument, because under modern debate, like, predictability is practically impossible, right? Like, there is no way when you have such a vague, open-ended resolution to really have any predictability, and to the point where we don't know what they're predicting or what they're expecting, the predictability actually turns on the affirmative case, on the affirmative team, because now we're expected to shape our plan based on what they expect the resolution means. Next, they talk about contextuality and fairness. However, we argue, like, you know, that they tell you that sometimes it's still linked, you know, that there's a correlation, and we argue that this is one of those times and there's still fairness, and that's proven by all the obvious argumentation that they have on the voters. They say that it's a priority issue. I'm not sure what this means. They never actually impact it out for you, really. I don't think they're doing enough work to explain to you what this means, and I don't speak Latin, so I don't know how this plays in this round. But secondly, they talk about fairness, but we argue that as long as the arguments that they ran still apply, like, we're not going to link out, well, we are going to link out, because it doesn't link to the criticism, not because we don't follow the resolution, which we do. Finally, they don't prove any specific words in the resolution that we violate, right? Like, they never give you any definition, any demarcation of what believe actually means and why their definition is better, right? Like, they never challenge any of our definitions by which we tell you that privacy is the idea of, you know, like, the exclusion of intrusion from your private affairs, and also our definition of believe, which means, you know, to endorse something. And to the point where that definition goes conceded, you will always see that the topicality goes away. Finally, I will defend the consequentialist approach, which is policy interpretation, for two reasons. The first one is that it increases education. When we actually talk about policies, it's better, like, it's easier to assess the impacts of something, right? It's easier to assess whether or not an action is good or bad. They would preclude that type of education, and you should reject them because of that. But secondly, we would argue that the consequentialist approach is a prerequisite to the value approach, right? Because when you believe in something, you endorse something, you do something to show that you believe in something, like most people that tell you, truly believe in God, sometimes they carry that out by either one, explaining why they believe in God, which in and of itself is an action, or secondly, like, exercising the right to religious expression by going to church or something like that. No? DA. My first argument is non-unique, right? Like, sex offenders already do this. Like, you know, there's already a registry in the system for sex offenders, which means that if this scenario was true, they, their impacts would have already happened. But we argue that this puts them in a double bind, because if it's not happening right now, there is no unique internal link analysis as to how it would happen post-plan. But secondly, if they argue that it would happen post-plan, we would argue, like, give me an internal link analysis. On the B point, they talk about how, like, they're already convicted. However, we argue that this will never outweigh the impacts that we give you, specifically about, like, you know, the massive amounts of people that are being killed because of violence. If you look at the impact analysis, they never impact it out for you. They don't tell you why this is intrinsically bad. They don't tell you that more encroachments on privacy will happen, so you should never look at that. But finally, we would argue that this is simply arguing for the status quo, which all the harms that we give you are, you know, showing that that's inherently problematic. But finally, we would argue that as they still get a trial, right? Like, so they're not automatically guilty. There is still they still have to go through the process of the legal system, and there is no impact to it. Now to the duty. Yes.
Yeah, you say that essentially this is non-unique because this is already happening in the status quo. So if it's already happening, like, what does your plan uniquely do?
No. It's not happening for domestic offenders. It's happening for sex offenders. But you're not giving me a break as to how that's uniquely different. So the impacts would have already happened if that was
your argument. You're saying sex offenders versus domestic.
My argument is, we already have, you argue that registry systems are bad because they lead to the non-existent impacts that you argue in the DA, but I would argue that, I'm arguing that if that's true, that would have already happened in the current registry system for sex offenders, which is not happening. And if it is happening, then it's not unique to the plan. Now onto the critique. Number one, we argue a permutation. We should always endorse the best solution in the plan, right, in this round. They don't ever tell you why the plan and the critique are functionally or mutually exclusive. But secondly, I would argue another firm, and that is the praxis firm, which means that only the only way to liberate ourselves from a larger system is to engage in action and thinking at the same time, right? Paulo Freire, who wrote Pedagogy of the Oppressed, contends that action without thinking leads to what he calls fatalist action or fatalist activism, which will always be co-opted by the state. But he argues that thinking without action leads to fatalist verbalism, which is simply talking about things without actually changing the realities of oppression that we see in the status quo. And this will be impacted out on the impact analysis that we tell you about how many people are being killed in the status quo. But finally, I would argue a feminist term, right? Like, we would argue that under theory of feminist analysis, we should always try to cooperate in the rounds to get the best solution in the round, right? Because they get up here and they talk about how we have to liberate ourselves from this gender binary of, you know, how we exclude transgender folks, and we argue that if that's the case, then we should do both at the same time because they're not mutually exclusive. I'm not at this moment. Next, they talk about specifically how Discourse shapes reality, and the only thing that matters is proof. Yeah, my first argument to this is a performative contradiction, right? In that case, why are they running? Are they running this post fiat critique? We would argue that this is inherently problematic because now we don't know if they're advocating pre-fiat impacts or post fiat impacts. And if they're arguing both, then their argument that fiat doesn't exist goes away, right? That's a performative contradiction and abusive in this round. But finally, they get up here and they talk about like how fiat is inherently bad, but we believe that fiat is intrinsically good because fiat is key to education, right? Like we can analyze the impacts of the plan. But finally, there's another performative contradiction. If fiat is an illusion, then how can you have pre-fiat implications? Like, I would like them to tell me that, and to the point where you don't know where that's taking place, I would argue that you should always reject them. Next, I will argue that the existence of fiat is key to assessing the pre-fiat impacts. We have to first imagine something before we can act upon it. Now onto the impact analysis. They get up here and they talk about how like we essentialized women, but we never said that the plan only applies to women. However, statistics do show that more women are affected by it, right? Like in the plan, we specifically tell you how spouses, partners, males, females, and intersexuals, and everyone is affected by this phenomenon, which means that you should always reject it based on that perspective, and that's specifically on feminism, which is the third advantage.
Criterion of what this plan does. My first response is you look to net benefits and we tell you like we're not essentializing and if you don't essentialize that's going to be the worst thing. Second, we say you also look to the dissad. Third, we say you also look to the critique because we say discourse is the most important thing in the round. With that in mind, go to the third advantage and extend Peter's argument that he turns the entire case because you reify the binary causing the zone of exclusion because you don't talk about transgenders, you only talk about men and women. Peter tells you this functions in the case as a turn. They never address that, so even if you don't think it's true, like they just don't respond to it, and as you said, Mark, like if they don't make the arguments against it, then there's no reason to vote for them. They don't make that argument, so you can extend that, and functionally it takes out case. So even if you're voting on the criterion, you never ever vote for Reno because they don't do the work to actually make sure their case stays in the round. With that in mind, go to resolutionality. Their first response is to say they have the right to parametricize. My first response to this is this is non-responsive. They're not parametricizing. They're changing the resolution from something that's supposed to be valued to something that they're saying can be a policy action. We would say that parametrization means to shrink the resolution, not to change the resolution, so they're non-responsive. I want you to extend Peter's number one and number two, where he tells you that belief inherently does not connotate action, and second of all, he says that what it does connotate is something descriptive rather than prescriptive. They never essentially address that as specific analysis. We tell you belief just means that you're describing something, not that you're prescribing some sort of future action. There might be a correlation, but that doesn't mean that there's some sort of causation. The next thing they say is that there's some sort of belief through action at the bottom of this position. The first problem with this is that you can flow across Peter's analytics that the word belief in and of itself is descriptive, not prescriptive. The second thing you tell you is that that's not always true. Like, how do you validate the existence of something through action? If I believe that unicorns exist, that doesn't necessarily mean I go out to see if they exist. It just means that I assume that they exist somewhere in the world. It doesn't connotate action. With that in mind, it means that they aren't automatically allowed to run some sort of policy. They're supposed to be running some sort of value or fact framework, and they never ever do that, which means you don't even look to their case because they don't fulfill the resolution onto the standards at the end of the position. The first thing they tell you is that limits is bad because it's a dichotomy, which leads to all these sorts of bad things. What we tell you, first of all, is that we're not saying that there's some sort of dichotomy. We're saying that you have to go to what the resolution says in terms of context in order to have a fair debate round. We tell you this is the prerequisite to any sort of substantive debate. Then they say it's bad because because we don't know what you could have predicted and it's not possible, etc. Our argument here is that there is predictability. The only predictability is the wording of the resolution, which means we have to look to what the words say. We tell you the word belief connotates something in the context of like our society, and so we have to follow what that means in order to have any sort of substantive debate. Then on fairness and context, all he says is that as long as there's correlation, they can run plan. We tell you if there's a correlation, you never want to vote on plan because it doesn't necessarily follow. If action doesn't necessarily follow, that means that you don't let them run some sort of action because all they can run is some sort of value and fact framework. They don't address the 3 and 4 standards, so I think you can extend fairness and you can extend context. We tell you context is important because the resolution provides the context for us to debate in this round, which is the most important thing in this round because that's all we have to go by, that's all we have to prep. extend the violation, go to the voters. First, he says, we never tell you why it's a priori. We tell you it's a priori because the basic burden is to fulfill the resolution, and resolution has words which have some sort of contextual meaning, and if you don't fulfill that, there's no reason to look to anything else because it's all a prerequisite to having a fair debate. Unfairness, they say, well, we're not going to link out of anything, but we're still going to be fair. We tell you fairness is to talk about what the resolution says, which is beliefs, not action. That's where the fairness analytic comes in, so he's functionally non-responsive. I think you could also extend jurisdiction as a voter, even if you don't want to go for the others. Then he tells you again that belief means endorsement. We tell you no, it's a description, not a prescription. Then he says policy is good because it's better for education and it's a prerequisite for value. My first resolution, my first point to this is that even if it's true that it's good for education, we would argue fairness always comes first because that allows for the education, that allows for the substantive debate, and you're always looking to fairness before you look to something that might be better because it creates some sort of unpredictable ground for us otherwise. And then on prerequisite to value, I would argue that this in fact is not true, that in fact it's the opposite, that you have belief first and then you have action. Their own analytics on the case of how sometimes there's a correlation means that belief always comes first. On to the dissad.
On that point?
Sure.
So just to clarify, under your interpretation of just the word believe, anytime the resolution says believe, it means that we cannot possibly present a plan.
It means that belief is something that you talk about fact and value.
So we can
you don't do something that's actually action. You can talk about what exists or what are facts. Okay, on the dissad, they say, well, we outweigh with the case. Our argument here is that this guess works. They say it's non-unique because there's already registries. My first response that I hear is that it's a linear dissad. We're not saying that this stuff doesn't happen. We're saying it does happen now, and it just gets worse with plan. But I think with that in mind, you can go to the links, and you can extend the number 3, where we tell you that neighbors can do anything, and like all the sorts of bad things that happen, you can extend the number 2, where people are presumed guilty until innocent. Like their argument that there's still a trial doesn't matter because there's this perception that they're already guilty, which means when they have a trial is unfair. But that means that the impact level is that it turns cases, we tell you first, because it violates their autonomy. Second of all, we tell you it's assumed guilty, which sort of shrinks this public and private sphere, which means that the government can do anything. And finally, we tell you this allows the state free reign. Even if you're weighing the ground in terms of like what the plan does, we tell you it's always going to be bad because they just don't address that analysis. On to the critique. First, they tell you firm is the best solution. Second, they tell you there's this practice perm because we can liberate with action and thinking. Finally, they say feminism perm. My first response is there's no text for any of the perms, so there's no reason to know, like we can't argue against it because there's no specific text on how they function in the round. My second response under here is like perming this shifts and is a moving target for them because we tell you that they bite the binary. That's what we tell you on case, that they assume that there's this male and woman and female binary and they bite that. So if they're trying to perm it, this means they're a moving target, which is uniquely abusive to us because they can always change their advocacy. Make them stick with their advocacy, which is on case, we tell you is assuming a binary and they can never get out of that link, so they can never get the perms. But additionally, on the praxis perm, we tell you that that first of all, they don't provide you Ferrari's actual warrants. They sort of say, well, Ferrari talks about the stuff in this book, but they don't provide you the warrants for why he believes what he does. Second, we would argue that the action in and of itself, because it's accompanied with their discourse and their belief of essentializing, means that they can never perm this because they can't perm something and then do something the exact opposite. We would say this is fundamentally bad, not only in the post-fiat world, but in terms of discourse. Then on the feminism perm, we tell you, first of all, they essentialize, so they can never get this feminism perm. Second of all, we tell you this is a shift. Then they tell you fiat is good. And we don't say it, justify a pre-fiat framework. My first response is Peter never tells you that we can't look to a post-fiat framework. He says that you look to discourse first. So, like, we're just saying that we outweigh, not that you can't talk about post-fiat impacts. Second of all, Peter doesn't even talk about pre-fiat. He talks about advocacy. He says the most important thing in the world is in this round is the assumptions that we make and the discourse we have in round because that shapes reality. He says when you're weighing it out, the sort of what they want to call post-fiat versus what we call advocacy, you say you're always going to be preferring what we say because that matters more because the fiat that they talk about is actually illusory. Then they try to talk about performative contradictions. They say, well, we talk about post-fiat, etc. No, Peter says that advocacy is important. You can talk about post-fiat, but advocacy is more important. Additionally, we never say pre-fiat, so again, they're not winning these contradictions. Then on the impacts, they say, well, we don't say only women are affected. First of all, they talk about feminism, like they're assuming that this affects uniquely women more. Like, that's all the analytics they give you. Even if they say they don't assume that, they talk about that in all of their rhetoric on case. You can just look back to the flow. Additionally, I'd argue that Peter tells you there's no universal experience of women, so at the point where they're talking about women as a group, that means they completely bite the critique and then they can never get this perm because they do this in the context of their PMC and they can never shift from that advocacy. So you can extend the impacts. First of all, we tell you they never solve the problem of intersectionality because they only talk about one type, like feminism or whatever they're talking about. So on the voters, we tell you this, that you, first of all, you want to reject them and not let them essentialize. And second of all, let people understand their identity in terms of different classes and how they intersect, not as one stable identity.
score is going to be tricot K. No, tricot case K. DA. The biggest problem Reno makes is conceding the first two analytics and the A point of the value resolution argument and never getting any kind of answers. They demand that we don't ever define belief, but we do in two ways at the top. We notice in the first point that there's no action verb in the resolution, and we tell you belief function is something that's descriptive, not prescriptive. I think once that's conceded, that's how the resolution functions. They try to say that they have the right to parametricize, but I don't think this is responsive. They have the right to parametricize to shrink down to an instance of policy or fact or value, not to simply change all the words and in whatever they want within the topic. So I think that we're still winning that this is what a belief is. So all we need to do is put a standard and a voter for this to be an easy way out without having to think about gender, without having to think about all of that debate, etc. So I think that the first standard that you can go for is the fairness standard and predictability. They say term predictability is impossible. I know, that's the kind of argument we're making. We're saying the only thing that's predictable is the resolution. We don't know what they're going to predict as a case, but we do have the resolution as some sort of predictable ground, as some sort of divider of what could be discussed. So we think at the point where they can go outside the resolution and suddenly change the wording to something else, then that means that that's the only standard we need to make. Now, they try to put more offense here by talking about the public-private argument, but I think that you're still looking to our argument about how they're doing a centralizing on that argument too, and we're not doing a dichotomy. We're just saying that there has to be limitations to the base. There's no binary. There's no dichotomy. So they're just not getting offense, and we're winning the predictability standard. So the violation's obviously very clear. They're doing a set of action, not doing any kind of normative value debate or making demands or talking about what we believe. They're doing that kind of argument. Now, they kind of try to say at the bottom that belief necessarily implies that we should be a little rather at the top, that we should test it through action. But I think Steve's analysis is great. There's a lot of beliefs people have that we can never validate through action. Like, if someone believes that unicorn exists or little kid believes Santa Claus exists, you never, like, you don't manifest those necessarily through action. And so I think that argument's always going to look through. So go to the voters. I think the easiest voter that you can go to is the jurisdiction voter. You say that you only have the jurisdiction given to you by the tournament. They're not answering back this analysis. So at the end of the day, they're conceding our interpretation of what belief looks like and how it's not descriptive. They're conceding that it's not prescriptive. They're conceding, I think, the argument about predictability, where the resolution's the only thing that's predictable, and you can concede the jurisdiction analysis. Insofar as they're violating that by running a plan, the easy way out is the tricot debate. But if you want to get messy, let's get dirty. I think the first place that you can vote for us also is going to be on the case debate. They don't get there because of time. That really hurts them because the offense there is, I specifically say this turns back case because they're reifying that gender distinction. They create the zone of exclusion, so they're always going to be hurting people that don't fall into the category of male or female. And since all they ever talk about is women getting hurt or men getting hurt, and they just try to blip about GLBT, I think that you're always going to be voting for Biola MV on this. At the point where this kind of oppression takes place, people fall out of our understanding of policy because we never consider people that aren't male or female. That means that's always going to be an offensive turn. That's a completely against case that's conceded. That's another easy way out for Biola MV. It's cold conceded. You don't have to get dirty anywhere else. But again, let's get dirty. I think on the critique debate, the biggest problem is they're trying to go for all these silly perms, because the problem with the perms that Steve identifies is there's no test, so you simply don't know how the perm functions with the PMC, but also all of these are shifts, because now they're saying we shouldn't be talking about men and women, or etc. But also keep in mind, in the third advantage, they talk about feminism. They assume a unique feminine essence. I think that the argument, the story here is still the same. On all the FIA debates, I think Steve's covering that pretty good. Our argument is that advocacy is what's important, and the analytic paradigms that we use are what's important. So when they assume a universal feminine essence, when ignoring like the intersection of where like the social forces and the social axes were, that means that there's always been a mask oppression. That's the impact I give you. Classism gets worse, racism gets worse if you just talk about feminism and if you never solve gender alleged issues. So I think that the voters, the impacts are always going to be functioning as case terms, and the voters are clear. You reject them and you allow people to identify themselves through themselves and not through their rhetoric.
That's the fam off case.
Right.
First, I'd like you to clearly extend all of the things that we've been giving you. This is clearly one of my favorite things to do in the world, and I'm happy you've given me the capability to do it. On the floor. Remember David's overview where he told you how our weighing mechanism has been completely conceded in this round, and that is instrumental net benefits as the criterion. They never actually provide you with a counter value, which means that you will only go with this to evaluate based on that evaluation. Remember, I want you to extend the facts that we tell you on the inherency that thousands of individuals are being massacred because of the privacy that we have in place. This is conceded. They conceded David's argument on how this outweighs any of the impacts that they give you because violence is factual, daily, and kills people. They don't tell you how much this essentialism K will outweigh, and they still don't have any of the impacts on the disadvantage. Remember, when you're voting, you're not voting on any pre-fiat implications. You have to evaluate the implications of even the criticism based on the post-fiat implementation of it, and any implementation of the alternative has to be able to function and compete based on that level. On resolutionality. They obviously end up going for this, but you're never going to vote for it for multiple reasons. The first off is I want you to pull across the argument that David gives you that we are allowed to parametricize to specific areas. The only offensive argumentation or warrants they give you here is new argumentation that says that you can't prove a belief in unicorns, you can't prove a belief in Santa Claus. However, I would argue that you would ultimately, you could run a case that hunts unicorns or have put candy underneath the tree so that Santa would have something to eat. Those would fundamentally prove the belief is true. But also I want you to pull across that you can assess belief through action. They don't give you any real reason why you couldn't assess a belief through an action, and specifically I give you reasons why you can, and I want you to extend David's argumentation. But furthermore, I want you to look specifically to the second argument on the limits debate. Ultimately, this turns back any of the standards. Even if you buy that we do somehow violate and we should have run it, or that you want to even buy that you should vote on it, we ultimately turn this back because in voting for it, you would justify a reversion of the predictability ground. You would essentially be forcing the affirmative run particular cases based on predictability, which would undercut our ground. Like, they never talk to you about this particular term because they never, they don't seem to understand it. But I want you to pull it across because it turns back even the fairness debate, which I want you to extend specifically. They make a huge tactical error when David gives you these the consequentialism argumentation. The first one is education. The only response that they put on this in the block is that fairness comes first. However, they never refute that consequentialism is key to education. So since I'm the last speech and I'm responding to the block, specifically you're going to look at education first, and I'll give you warrants for it. The first is that education is the only real out-around discourse that you can, or the only real impact that you can get, but also secondly, you're looking at education first because that's what this is about. That's why it's funded by the education system. If you ever undercut education, and I know you want a POI, but I am arguing that this argumentation came out in the block, and this is the first chance we can respond to it.
Point of order.
Under consideration.
Cool.
What's the time on that?
3 minutes.
She's so long.
Ready?
Yes. No.
Moving on to case. Ultimately, what is important for you to extend here is specifically the net benefits under instrumentalism criteria that we give you. That's how you have to weigh the round because it's pretty much conceded coming out of them, but I will deal with the critique flow specifically, and I want you to extend specifically advantage one and advantage two, where we give you direct causal effects which outweigh the disadvantage. Specifically on the disadvantage, they don't even really go for this argumentation, but I want you to pull across, if you were thinking on voting for it, that they never quantify any real impacts for you, and advantage one and advantage two clearly outweigh, and that's the argumentation that David gives you, and it's not refuted. Moving on to the critique. This is the only chance at offense that they get. However, they completely mishandle how the perms are run, right? They say that there's no text for any of the perms, but this is intrinsically not necessary, right? The perms intrinsically test any type of competition. If a permutation can exist, therefore their argument and our argument are not competitive, meaning that our argument and their argument are not in competition. They're not mutually exclusive argumentations. So they don't need a text, because if they just kicked the K position, which they should have done, then you would never have had it. But also, secondly, they claim that this creates a moving target and is incredibly abusive. However, I turn this back saying that we were only able to run the permutation in the last block, and furthermore, the permutations clearly function as tests of competition, which isn't an advocacy, nor do we shift our advocacy. But moving on to the specific perm argumentation. I only have to win one of the perms at the point at which any one of the perms proves non-competition. The first perm I want you to extend...
Saying that perms function as a test of competition is not in the MG. We have the perm, the praxis, the fem, the best solution,
and
but
my,
never theoretically.
My argument against this is specifically against whether or not we need text.
Yeah.
Under consideration.
Okay.
423.
Okay. I only need to win one of the permutations to prove this. I want you to extend across the first perm, which they put absolutely no line by line on, right? They talk about the practice perm and they talk about the fem perm, but the only arguments that you get on the first general perm is the one and two arguments where the general, you need text, and you need, it would be a moving target if you don't have text. So extend that they accept that this ultimately does co-opt and prove that there is no, or it at least proves that a permutation exists. On that, I want you to extend across the performative contradiction. Remember, they never give you a clear analysis on why or how fiat even exists or doesn't exist. We get clearly that the fiat doesn't exist coming out of their block, or that fiat is illusory, but then they also say that you can weigh the post-fiat implications of both the case and this. Ultimately, the only clear voting issue that you have is the net benefits based on instrumentalism, which is why you vote with that and not their framework.